kind of unity of consciousness. It's all of knowledge which is not only enshrined in the Grantha, because there is a definite textual tradition. Because many people say, orality hai, Granth kaha hai. We have a long textual tradition to support what is vitally part of the Indian thinking. By vitally part of Indian thinking, thinking of the masses. And some of the problems that we have been academically handling are, I don't want to use the word challenge or things like that. Some of the issues that have been, we've been handling are, for example, the issue of whether there is a rupture between our grand knowledge tradition and what is now called contemporary knowledge. Contemporary knowledge, is there a rupture? Or is it that there is a continuity as long as the Indian mind is concerned? Because the Indian mind is not has never been and should not be a monolith. It's a complex production of diverse streams of thought that have been inputs for this. But in that complex Indian mind, the continuity is there. Some of the people have heard my elders. They use the river analogy that India's knowledge tradition are like the Sanatana Ganga Pravah. That's an expression what the Bhagavad Shastri used to use very often. He, by that analogy, he meant that there is a long forgotten, almost inaccessible source, because the ancient texts are by and large inaccessible directly, although they have been vernacularized in Indian languages and made kind of sediments in the average Indian mind. They have settled down, those thoughts have settled down as sediments in the Indian mind. But like all rivers, there are seasonal changes. When there is summer of thought, summer, then this river becomes a very small stream. But when the rains come, when the climate is more positive, then the river again flows in its full youth. There have been, in the India's history of ideas, cycles of loss and recovery. And there will be repeated cycles. It is typified by our concept of Vyas as a parampara and not as an individual. Because 28 Vyasas and the through examination of various statements in various kinds of materials, the Vyasa Parampara means somebody who once again resurrected the knowledge, which either for external or internal reasons was lost. The resurrection is symbolized by reformulation of the Rig Veda. That is the mark. Saraswati Rishi, because he did not complete. And Veda Vyasa. And in one of my controversial writings, I called Maximilla the 29th Vyasa. Because in 19th century, we reconstructed the Rig Veda text. Many people quarreled with me and did not, because we are more used to abusing people, the Britishers and others, than praising them for what they have done. So, in that loss and recovery process, cycle, I have a feeling that we are at the beginning of the process of recovery, once again. And that's why scholars like Mehta ji rare, rare combination of complete mastery of Western thought and an equally deep, wide-ranging mastery of India's knowledge traditions and texts. That is important because he has read the texts, and therefore he has a comparativist vision, and he takes up the issues which are sometimes, you know, the what we call, you know, they are used by the competing knowledge traditions to browbeat us or to denigrate our knowledge traditions. And it is possible for a man like Mehtaji to take the issues up front and on a level ground, unless we have mastery of our own knowledge tradition and also the Western tradition, we will not be on the level ground. I generally, whenever I happen to be asked to speak like this, I always remember my good friend Bhasri. And Mehtaji knows that's a very strange friend. I started with people, you know, long ago, long forgotten, but not really forgotten, not really gone, not very much present. He said, what does he know who knows only his own tradition? Because the mind acquires a critical acumen by interacting with other traditions. Now that was a confident India, 5th century, when the Indian knowledge was the focus of the world learning, and people used to come from various universities, had been coming from China, Japan, Middle East, and what you have, to our centers of learning. Today we call such centers universities, centers of learning like Taxila and Nalanda, Vallabhi, and so many, 7 or 8 that matter we will tell you about today. And they were coming, and there was a very eclectic, comprehensive, wide-ranging inquiry into human life and its environment. And that was confident India. Unfortunately, today, instead of saying, what does he know who knows only his own tradition, we have to say, what does he know who does not know his own tradition? That is the cycle. And I think that has to be undone. And in that process, I'm very thankful, Bakaranji, that you invited Mehtaji in that process. And he is going to talk about a wonderful, very contemporary subject. Because contemporary subjects are generally, you know, the mode is in several ways you can see. It's not simple expounding of something, but interacting with something. There's a Purvapaksha, there's another point of view. We have a very strong other point of view today, the contemporary Western Christian civilization. And from that, many standpoints come, issues come, to which we have to respond. Sometimes we have a ground to respond on. Sometimes we have to construct the ground to respond on. And that his subject today is going to be freedom of speech, inquiry, and religion in India and in the West. But this is interesting. First time when sir talked to me, he didn't have this and in the West. And I'm glad now he's here because he's taking the battle to the other side. Our national sport is kabaddi. Kabaddi mein hum dusre ke paale mein jaate hain. So intellectually, dusre ke paale mein jana zaruri hai. If you have to stay. So thank you very much, sir, for accepting our invitation and being here and talking to us. We'll be absolutely delighted to listen to you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
To Professor Mehta yesterday, so without further ado, I invite him to guests, ladies and gentlemen. Today I'm going to be speaking about freedom of inquiry, speech and religion in India and the US. And it's very appropriate that I'm doing it here at the Indian Institute for Advanced Study in Shimla, an institution, a great institution, founded by none other than our second president of India, Professor Sarvapalli Ramakrishnan. And it's appropriate not just because the topic is something that he would have deeply appreciated, but also because I'm going to quote directly from some of the things that he wrote. Now, the plan for the talk today is I'm going to talk about a little bit about the philosophical underpinnings of freedom of inquiry, speech, and religion, because all three are linked. And I'm going to share with you some historical evidence also about how this was actually put into practice by data, inscriptional evidence. So this is hard evidence carved in stone on at least 50 dynasties. So I'll give you in summary form, you won't have time to go into all of that. All the details will be available in the literature and in the book that is that I'm planning on this. And then, similarly, I'm going to compare the Western philosophical underpinnings and also identify several key individuals whose life stories are very indicative of how the parallel tradition operates. In terms of the philosophical underpinnings, I'm going to start, as we must, with the Rig Veda, and in particular how the origins of plurality and freedom of inquiry are already present in, as it were, the foundational core text of the Asian civilization. And then, of course, I trace the threads that we find in the Rig Veda all through the history of Indian civilization. And I'll do the same thing. Now, what is interesting is that freedoms have really been about four separate domains. And the most contentious domain has always been the religious domain. Was, is, and perhaps will be, followed closely by the social realm, the political realm, and the scientific realm. And pretty much in that order. Now, if we have to understand this, let's start with India. And the most interesting comment in this connection that I have seen is actually from Max Weber's work on India. And I will quote the original German, but I'll use the translation here. He said, for long periods, tolerance towards religious and philosophical doctrines was almost absolute. He's talking about India. At least it was infinitely greater than anywhere in the Occident until most recently. This is from his original 1923 work. And this was then subsequently translated into the English in 1923. And as you can see, even in German, the word that he uses is Tolerance. And he talks about Nahezu Absolut, you know, the absolute freedom, Zeitraum. This is something that he noticed, and by the way, remember that by 1923, the first fruits of theological scholarship had become available in Germany and in England and in Europe broadly. So even on the basis of the texts that he had access to, and of course subsequently in the next 100 years, many more texts have come to light, he could not have had access to everything that he had access to today. But even on the basis of what he had access to, he came up with this stunning summation, which I think sums up very nicely what we're going to talk about today. So how did this happen? Now, what is interesting is that this tolerance, this plurality, is there in this famous hymn, which is from the first mandala, the 164th richa, the 46th line, Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Varana. This is something that we are all familiar with. Professor Ranganathan, or Swami Ranganathan Ananda, called this the Magna Carta of religion. very, very interesting observation. This is the Magna Carta of religion. Because this gave India the charter for freedom of inquiry, for freedom of religion, for freedom of speech. Now,
furthermore, the same idea is elaborated, and here I'm quoting actually from Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan's translation, but I have the original down below as well. So this is the conversation between Vidagdha Shakalya and Yajnavalkya. So Yajnavalkya basically asks, or rather Vidagdha Shakalya asks Yajnavalkya, how many gods are there? And the answer that he gives is very, very interesting. He says first of all, 303, 3003, 33, 6, 3, 2, 1.5, 1. And by the way, in this he summarizes, as it were, a large part of the development of Indian philosophy. You know, you have the Advaita, that is 1. You have the Vishishta Advaita, 1.5. You have the Advaita, which is 2. You have, you know, the Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshi of the Trinity, that is 3. And you can go on, you can go on from there. So the point is that this plurality was there. But it's not just plurality, it is something more. This puzzled, and I'll come to what else is there, but it puzzled the Indologists who first encountered it. In particular, the first Westerner who encountered the Rig Veda and created the critical edition, Max Muller, he said that it is not just the fact that there is this plurality, it is that although many gods are invoked in different hymns, sometimes also in the same hymn, yet there is no rule of precedence that is established amongst them. This is extremely important. Sometimes it is Indra, the god of the blue sky, sometimes it is Agni, the god of fire, sometimes it is Varuna, the ancient god of the firmament, who are praised as supreme without any suspicion of rivalry or any idea of subordination. Now, in mathematical terms, it's like you say that space is infinite in all directions, but you can create the coordinate system starting at any point in that infinite space. So I could set up the coordinate system here, I could set up the coordinate system outside this room, I could set up the coordinate system in Delhi, I could set up the coordinate system in Greenwich. You could take anything as the basis, and you can say, this is my fixed point of inquiry, this is where I'm beginning, but then I'm also taking cognizance of the others, they're not in any way subordinate. The fact that I'm taking something as the kendra does not mean that the others are subordinate, because I can very well shift the kendra or the center elsewhere. Now he was puzzled enough because he contrasted it with Rome and Greece. And he said, our ideas of polytheism being chiefly derived from Greece and Rome, we understand by it a certain more or less organized system of gods, different in power and rank, and all subordinate to a supreme god, a Zeus or a Jupiter. The Vedic polytheism, by the way, the word that he uses is polytheism, and he realizes quickly that this is not the right word, differs from Greek and Roman polytheism, and therefore, he came up with not one, but two separate words to describe this phenomenon. He called it kathenotheism in some places and enotheism in other places. This is the worship of one god after another. Kathenotheism or enotheism is the term that he came up with. So this, I submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, that this is the foundational drishti. This is the foundational point of view of the Indian civilization, and it's enshrined in perhaps the two foremost historical texts that have come to us of the Indian tradition, that is the Rig Veda and the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, and indeed in pretty much every major text that we have. Now, I'm also now quoting from the rock edict of Ashoka, the 12th rock edict, and here I'm using the Sanskrit Chaya or the Sanskrit gloss. Because one problem that you run into in looking at the edicts of Ashoka is that all of them are localized, right? So you'll have an edict in Aramaic, you'll have an edict in Greek, you'll have an edict in the local Western Prakrit, the Eastern Prakrit. So And by the way, it's a fascinating exercise to see the Greek comparisons. You know, for example, the word that he uses for religion or dharma in Greek is Eusebia. Very interesting word. So scholars have hit upon the technique, which I like very much, of back, not translating, chaya is the right word, of the chaya technique of putting it back in Sanskrit, because then you have a common reference point. And in fact, that is probably why Sanskrit evolved in the first place, that it became the common reference point for everybody. So I'm using the Sanskrit equivalent. So he says, sarva pashanda bahushruta kalyana gamascha bhave yurim. Now the word that he uses is bahushruta. And by the way, this word also exists in the Pali Tripitaka, and interestingly enough, also in the Jain Agam. So I went and checked. So Mahavir has a sermon on Bahusuye, which is the practical word of the Bahushruta. So this goes back to the point that Professor Kapoor talked about. He does not know his own tradition, who only his own tradition knows. So the point is that a scholar has to be a Bahushruta, that is, he has to look at the plurality of viewpoints on his own or her own tradition. And only then can that person be a scholar. And by the way, this is there in the Rocky Deep of Ashoka. He wishes that on his subjects, that they be Bahushrutas. And of course, we have the ancient notion, Vade Vade Jayate Tattva Bodha. But I want to now actually share with you something which is equally interesting, because this is where this idea was codified in the form of rules of debate and doctrine. And intellectual doctrine formulation. So this is the famous dialogue between the Greek king Menandros and the Buddhist sage Nagasena. So the king asks him, and by the way, I'm going to now quote directly from the Pali, because we have to understand the rhythm of the Pali. So I've pulled it up here. I'm sorry, I should have copied it here, but I just realized this morning that I haven't done that. So I just pulled this up from the Pali Tripitaka. So this passage is actually, and this whole dialogue, Milinda Panna or Milinda Prashna in Sanskrit, is actually part of the Pali canon. It's part of the Tripitaka, it's part of the Kutarkaka, which is the miscellaneous portions. And it's the Milinda Panha part of the Kuddak Nikaya of the Sutta Pitta, you know, from the direct sayings of the Buddha and other important sayings. So it is not an incidental statement that you find in a subsidiary text. This is part of the main Pali canon, right, of how things ought to be. And so the king asks Nagasena, so how is it that scholars discuss things? So he says, katham bhante nagasena pandita salapantiti. How do they discuss things? So Nagasena says, panditanam ko maharaja salape avethanthampi kayariti nibethanthi kayariti nigahopi kayariti pattakamapi kayariti vissasopi kayariti, pativissa, sopi, kayariti, etc., etc. And you can see the English translation. When scholars talk a matter of words, and I'm sure you could sense that rhythm there, right? He's talking about the back and forth of scholarship. So they talk a matter over with one another. There's a winding up and an unraveling. Somebody is convicted of an error, then he acknowledges his mistake, distinctions are drawn, contradistinctions, and yet thereby they're not angered. Isn't it beautiful?
Yeah.
Then he says, so how is it that kings discuss? So again, I'm going to quote. So, Raja no ko Maharaja sallape ekam vattu pati jananti. And you can imagine, even those who don't know Pali will understand immediately. Ekam vattu pati jananti. Knows only one particular point of view. And more importantly, yotam vattu vilometi tasad Dandam Anapenti. So if anybody differs from him on that point, he's apt to find him saying, inflict on him such and such a punishment upon that fellow. Right? This is how kings discuss, this is how scholars. So he said, so then Nagasena says, so how would you like to discuss this? And he said, I would like to discuss it with you as a scholar. And I think you can't find a better epitomization of what the Indian tradition is all about than this dialogue. And I think this is the beauty of reading the original. It reads, this, it of course reads spectacularly even in translation, but you get the rhythm of the back and forth when you actually hear the Pali spoken. So, one other thing. So, it's very interesting that Nagasena, Milind or Menandros have this discussion. So what it does is that it very clearly establishes a precedence. That is to say, it is the king who defers to Nagasena and not vice versa. And the best example of this that I found is from an eyewitness account of the morning assembly in Vikramshiri. This is from an obscure translation from Tibetan in 1893. It took me a year and a half to track this translation down. This journal was published only for 8 years and then it shut down 120 years ago. And there is a direct translation of an eyewitness account of this morning assembly. So the context is that there is a delegation which has come from Tibet to request Atish Dipankar, the foremost scholar of his day, to come to Tibet. So of course they have not met, the delegation has never met Atish Dipankar, so they come at night. And then they basically say, where will we find the Honorable Atisha? So they say, there's a morning assembly there, you will find him there. So they go and wait in the morning assembly, and what they find is something which is astounding. The morning assembly at Vikramshiri consisted of 8,000 scholars, right? And 8,000 bhikshus and other scholars assembled there. And what he finds is something very interesting. He finds that the king is sitting in the audience. This is an eyewitness account, mind you, in Tibetan. And then everybody, furthermore, when the king had come in, nobody rose for him. None of the bhikshus, none of the assembly rose for him. But when Atish Dipankar comes, and then he describes Atish Dipankar, resplendent, you know, Vaidityaman, resplendent in his yellow robes, in the orange robes of a bhikshu. And very interestingly, the eyewitness account said that he had a girdle on his waist where a lot of keys were hanging. So he was also, remember, he was also an administrator, right? So he obviously had keys to lots of rooms and, you know, all the administrative paraphernalia that that is involved in running an institution. So everybody rises for him, including the king. Now I think if these two episodes, both of which are historical episodes, preserved in the Pali and the Tibetan traditions, if these do not exemplify what inquiry was in the Indian tradition, I think nothing does. In fact, it's difficult to find anything anywhere else in the world which has that comparable grandeur. Okay. So, I also want to mention that Gunther, in his biography of one of the Tibetan saints, basically said that in Nalanda, there was a debate between a Buddhist and a Vedantin, presided over by the king. And the king said, I'm the impartial patron of both parties, so I don't have a horse in this race. I'm basically just going to focus on, essentially, may the best person win. Similarly, there's a very interesting debate that occurred in 654 AD between Xuanzang, you know, the famous Chinese monk, and Pragyadeva, who was the Mahasthavara of the Mahabodhi monastery. Now, we know about this particular debate because Pragyadeva sends a letter to Xuanzang, which is preserved in Chinese, which is preserved in several other Central Asian languages. So obviously it created a great stir. And he said that they participated in a grand public debate. Now we know this from other records of the reign of Harshvardhan. So this happened in Kannauj, in the presence of several thousand people, including several princes, several hundred princes who came from all over India. And they, and these two individuals debated. Now one, Xuanzang, being Chinese, was a Mahayanist. And Pragyadeva, being from the Mahabodhi monastery, was a Theravada, right? So remember, these two streams of Buddhism are more different from each other than Protestants are different from Catholics. Why? Because Protestants and Catholics revere the same text, which is the New Testament, right? However, the Mahayanists, while they revere the texts of the Theravada tradition, they revere their, which are the suttas, they revere the hundred or so sutras that they have in Sanskrit a lot more. So they will, for example, give a lot more credence to the Pragyaparamita Sutra or the Vajracheidika Sutra and so on. There are over 100 of those. And they are far more important for the Mahayanist tradition than are the Pali scriptures, which they also report. So the point that I'm making is that they are far more distant from each other than are Protestants and Catholics. Yet, what is interesting is that when Pragyadeva sends this letter, he sends a letter of apology. He said, "Sir, you and I debated for 2 days. This debate lasted for 2 days, several days actually. But you and I debated for 2 days. And in the heat of the argument, my voice rose. You're a wonderful scholar. Please accept this small token of my appreciation." And he sends a small gift, some textiles and some sutras, you know, some sutras that Xuanzang was looking for that he wasn't able to collect. So he sends this to China. Mind you, this is going to China. Now, Xuanzang responds back. He said, "Sir, you're such a great scholar. My voice also rose in the heat of argument. I also duly apologize." And here too, he also sends a token of his appreciation, and then he adds a beautiful line. He said, "You are so smart. How come you're not a Mahayanist?" And he says, "Time is not lost. You can still see the error of your ways. Come be a Mahayanist before the end comes to you." So now this is the way. Now think about how these two scholars, the Chinese and an Indian, how respectfully they talked about this. And this is, I've taken this from the Chinese translation, first into German and then into English. So all this is basically well attested, etc. All right. Here again, by the way, you may wonder, the charge is often leveled against Buddhism that they did not critique the social order very much. So here what I've done is that I've quoted from the Pramanvartik Svavritti Tika of Dharmakirti, where he says, he was a logician at Nalanda. He says, "These are the five marks of crass stupidity of witless men. The unquestioned authority of the Vedas, the belief in a world creator, the quest of for purification through ritual bathings, the arrogant division into castes, and the practice of mortification to atone for sin." Now, I mean, if you were to put up a list of all the things that are objectionable in some way, shape or form to others, you know, in the Indian tradition, this is perhaps the biggest, best summary you can come up with. And he was forthright enough to talk about this without any hesitation whatsoever. So the point is that this critique of the fact that you could critique religion, the fact that you could critique the social order, this was something that was taken for granted. Similarly, scientific order. Here I'm quoting basically directly from one of the colophons of Aryabhatiya, and basically, it mentions that Aryabhatta was the Kulupa of Kusumpura. Kusumpura is another name for Patiputra. So apparently, there was an observatory in the early 5th century AD to which, where Aryabhatta basically was the Kulupa. And what is interesting is that he completely he gives a heliocentric view of the universe, something that later on Galileo and Tycho Brahe and others and Copernicus were persecuted for. So this is something in the 5th century AD, without any problem, as the head of an institution, he's able to propound a new scientific theory. So remember, I gave you the list of 4 freedoms. I won't have time to go into all of this in great detail, but I just thought I'd touch upon the direct textual references for all of these. All right, so now I'm going to actually share with you in summary form the practice of this freedom of religion by giving you legends that we have used for different faiths that were supported at different times in India, of course including Islam but also including Judaism and Christianity, right? Because, and here I'm essentially taking the dynastic lists up to the 12th century AD, up to the destruction of Nalanda and so essentially from the 8th century BC, from when we have records, to the 12th century, for about 2,000 years, roughly. So these are the symbols that I use. And what we did is that we compiled the dynastic list of all the dynasties about, so here I'm going to show you the summary patronage for about 48 or 50 dynasties. We have subsequently, in the last year or so, which I have not been able to summarize so far, extended this to pretty much every dynasty in the last 2,000 years. I mean, not last 2,000, but from 8th century to the 12th century, 8th century BC to the 12th century BC, about 98 separate dynasties and their religious patronage. Again, based on textual or inscriptional evidence. So in each case, we have a primary reference, not a secondary reference. So we have sent over 1,000 references now to these 100 dynasties and the religious. And so this is just a summary. So if you look at the Mauryan Empire, what is interesting is that they patronized several different religions, starting with the Mauryan Empire, right? For example. Now, we have data on the Nandas as well, which I'm not showing you here. If you look at the Mauryan Empire, Chandragupta Maurya, by common tradition, was a Jain. His son Bindusara was an Ajivik. His son Ashoka was a Buddhist. So grandfather is one religion, son is another religion, grandson another religion. And they patronized many more. They patronized Brahmins, they patronized Brahminism or Vedantic religion, and many other sects. And of course, there were at least 18 shamanic sects that were patronized. The Gupta Empire, similarly, you can see that the Kushan Empire, the Taka, the Gupta Empire, the Lichinis of Nepal, the Mai Dynasty, Mokharis, Pushyabhuti Dynasty, the Chachas, the Karakokas, the Hindu Shahis, the Utkalas, the Loharas. These are the North Indian dynasties, and see the religions that they patronized. Northeast, from Varman to the Ahoms, again you see a deep plurality of what it is that they were patronizing. Northwest and West, Maitrakas, by the way, fascinating, I'll talk about this in a minute. The Maitrakas, the Kalachuris, the Guhilas, the Chahamanas, the Paramars, and so on, Rashtraputas, Chalukyas, Yadavas. These are, see their patronage. Similarly, South India, the Pallavas, the Kadams, the Gangas, the Cheras, the Pandyas, the Chalukyas, the Kulashekharas, the Cholas, the Chalukyas, the Vaishalas, and the Kakatiyas. Again, see the broad level of patronage. You know, for example, the Kulashekharas are patronizing Islam, Christianity, Judaism, and of course, all the traditions of Hinduism. In 1000 AD, there's a land grant that is given to for the building of a Jewish temple. We have detailed land records available for that. So all those, you can see, this is part of the glorious tradition of Indian pluralism. And of course, Akbar and Darashiko, I won't go into this, you know, this is now familiar territory. Majmal Bahrain and some of the Sangam created these and created these correspondences that created the table of... So essentially what he said is that if you consider Vedantic thought, and if you look at Orthodox Islamic thought, Brahman is the same as Allah, and so on. All of these, basically, he creates the equivalences between Arabic and Sanskrit and says that I don't see much of a difference. And what I'd like to, and by the way, it's a misconception to believe that there were only six schools of Indian philosophy. This list from Agarwal is 28 separate schools. And there are, this, of course, is only a partial list. There's a much bigger list that I will share with you a little later. But now, since time is short, let me spend a little bit of time on the parallel tradition in the West, and then I will come up with a summing up, a framework for summing up. Now, in the West, actually, you can just skip this. So, it's commonly understood that the birthplace of Western thought is Ionia, or Greece. And in particular, the seminal thinker for the West is, of course, Socrates. And the safest character, and so now, Whitehead famously said that the history of Western philosophical, European philosophical tradition is that it consists of a series of footnotes to Plato. And Plato himself says that everything that is good and beautiful is in Socrates. So essentially, Socrates is the Ur, or the original Western philosopher. So he says, and Plato says that kalos kai neos, everything that is good and beautiful, good and new, is in Socrates. So now, what did the West do to Socrates? I've taken this painting, you know, from Jacques-Louis David in the Museum of Modern Art in New York. This is the famous death of Socrates, you know, where he's forced to drink hemlock and put to death. Now, exactly what was the charge against Socrates? So what I did is that I actually went and pulled up the charge sheet against Socrates in Greek. By the way, this was Diogenes Laertius in 250 AD makes an incredible claim that the actual indictment against Socrates was still publicly posted in the town square in Athens 600 years after the actual trial. So it was a climacteric event in Western political evolution. And exactly what was the charge against Socrates? So there are two versions that are available, and I'm quoting this in Greek. Look at the phrase that I have put in bold. Hetera de daimonia kaina. Hetera, as in other, or hetero, you know, hetera de daimonia. Daimon is gods. Daimon, demon, the same root. Atman is another translation, kaina. So he says, because he believes in other new spiritual, so two charges against him: he corrupts the youth, and he believes in other gods which are not sanctioned by the state. Now, when people talk about Socrates being put to death, they say that he was put to death for his troublesome views, but they don't really point out that the primary reason why he was put to death was because of blasphemy. That he was questioning the gods that were sanctioned by the political order in Greece. Number one. Number two, the other thing you have to remember, they talk about Greek democracy. In a population of about 200,000 people, there were 30,000 adult male Athenian citizens, 120,000 slaves. It took me a while to get the actual textual references to the compilation, right? But out of 240,000 people, 120,000 were slaves. Only 30,000 people could vote. Women and children could not vote, obviously. And the slaves could not vote. There were 120,000 of them. So, the point is, they talk about freedom and freedom of various sorts, but it was a deeply unfree society and remained so. Mind you, we won't go into this, there are over 100 references approving to slavery in the Old and the New Testaments. So we talk about the caste system in India, of course. It is something that became ossified and draconian, something that we must fight. But in the process of criticizing the caste system, let's not forget that there was a general movement in human history from tyranny, from oppression to freedom. And to say that somehow that there was much greater oppression in India, I'm afraid, is not supported by the facts. Yes, there was the caste system, but remember, first of all, as I've already indicated, the critique of the caste system was always there in the Indian tradition. And where did that critique come from? Primarily, it came from the Shramanic tradition. The tradition of which Buddha and Mahavira were just two exemplars. This tradition coexisted with the Vedic tradition. It's not something that developed around 500 BC, as is sometimes mistakenly assumed. The Shramanic tradition is there mentioned in the Rig Veda. In particular, the words that are used for the Shramanas are Muni and Vratya. Vratya, that is those who take the Vrata, as do the Jains and the Buddhists. They take certain vows, right? Hindus or Vedantins take Diksha. The Shramanic tradition takes vows. There is no notion of Diksha. So this parallel tradition is there, referenced in the Rig Veda. And this tradition was always critical of the caste system, never gave it any legitimacy, never recognized it as a necessary evil for the time being in society, but something that must be countered at every step of the way. You can't completely wish it away, so you take cognizance of it, but you counter it. And I've already shared with you what one of the Dignan, one of the famous logicians in Nalanda, what he talked about in relation to the caste system, how he opposed it. So it's extremely important to understand that the parallel critique in India, the parallel move towards freedom was much stronger than anything in the West, and this is something that we have to definitely bring to the fore. Now, again, you have to understand why was Christ crucified? He was crucified because of his religious doctrine. And here I'm quoting directly from Mark. He said, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." He says, basically, "Are you Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" And he says, "Yes." So he is crucified, and then the Jewish intelligentsia and the Jewish priesthood take strong exception to that and say, "How can a mere mortal claim that he is the Son of God?" And then, of course, for that reason, he's crucified. So let us not forget that the two founding individuals of the Western tradition, Socrates and Christ, are both put to death for their views. Let's not forget. This point was noted by Mill, none other than John Stuart Mill. He says, "Two individuals who are pivotal to the development of the Western thought, indeed world thought, are both put to death by his countrymen." Socrates was put to death by his countrymen after a judicial conviction for impiety and immorality. And I'm quoting Mill directly, "Christ was ignominiously put to death as what? As a blasphemer." Mill's Essay on Liberty talks about this. So both were victims of free speech. Now, this is the irony. So you would think that Mill would be on the side of angels, then only partly. He says, "Liberty has no application to any state of things anterior to the time when mankind has become capable of being improved by free and equal discussion. Until then, there is nothing for them but implicit obedience to an emperor or a Charlemagne, if they are so fortunate as to find one." And the British, he of course doesn't quite put it that way, that until the Indians become civilized, they have to be ruled by somebody like an Akbar or the British. So remember, unlike the Indian tradition where liberty and freedom of inquiry is for all, in the Western tradition, right up until Mill, we're talking about the 19th century now, they justify tyranny, they justify illiberality, they justify all the restrictions of freedom of speech. Locke, a slave owner, he actually held significant stakes in a slave owning company. So not only did he own slaves, he owned shares in company in a company that trafficked in slaves. And he has the gall to write a letter concerning toleration, but it's specifically a toleration between different Christian sects. It does not even extend to Catholics. So these are the ironies, basically, that you find in the Western tradition, that the liberality and the freedom of thought and the freedom of expression is until the recently circumscribed. Some more. Immanuel Kant. Now, Immanuel Kant published a fascinating book that Derrida and others commented upon, and actually, I believe, even several others in the 1950s and 70s and 80s commented upon. This book had been forgotten. The book called The Conflict of the Faculties. This was his second last book, the penultimate book that he wrote. It was in response to the King of Prussia, Frederick Wilhelm II, who initiated a set of repressive measures against German universities. So what was, the king charged Kant with how you misuse your philosophy to distort and disparage many of the cardinal and basic teachings of the Holy Scriptures and of Christianity. This is 1798. He says, correct this. Failing this, you must expect unpleasant measures for your continuing obstinacy. Mm-hmm. Remember, he is arguably the most eminent philosopher of his time. And the king, see the dynamic difference, right? Think about the king of Magadha at that time and Atish the Panka on the one hand.
Or Nagasena
and Menandros or Milind. And King Frederick Wilhelm II and Immanuel Kant. So he, Kant replies, I never could have mixed any evaluation of Holy Scriptures and of Christianity into my lecture. So he's already backtracked. So he doesn't, so he says, I would never dare to criticize Christianity. I make no appraisal of Christianity. I cannot be guilty of disparaging it. Now remember, in the Indian tradition, they were thoroughly critiquing different points of view, and I showed you several critiques, right? It is only natural religion that I appraise. And he says the only possible occasion for misunderstandings is the fact that I cite some biblical texts to corroborate certain purely rational teachings in religion. So this is now late 18th century. Charles Babbage, the person who created the first programming machine, entered Cambridge in 1810 but could not graduate because his honors thesis, which required a public defense on God as a material, public defense on God as a material agent, his interlocutor, Reverend Thomas Jefferson, deemed it to be blasphemous and disqualified. Remember, up until 1810, all students at Oxford and Cambridge had to subscribe to the Anglican Articles of Faith. Not only that, until 1871, every single faculty member at Oxford and Cambridge had to subscribe to the 29 Articles of Faith of the Anglican Church. Suppressed. You don't hear about this. You don't want to talk about it. Now, Max Müller, he absolutely wanted the Bowdoin Professorship at Balliol College, Oxford. My college. The college where the chair of Sanskrit is established. He evidently deserved it. What was his sin? The fact that he was not an Anglican, but that he was a German Protestant, a Lutheran. So they would not even countenance a Lutheran. And in fact, there was a campaign against him, which is catalogued very nicely in Nirad Chaudhry's book, Scholar Extraordinary, about the life of Max Müller, about how he was vilified for not being a true Christian. And therefore, a separate chair was created for him in a different college. And he never really achieved his dream of being the professor of Sanskrit at Oxford. So he wrote his, edited his sacred works of the East, not as a professor of Sanskrit, but as a professor of philology. So there are many ironies there. And this test was only abolished in 1871. So you could not be a faculty member without subscribing to the Church of England. Now, why talk about the 19th century? In 1918, Bertrand Russell was jailed for 6 months for writing an article that insulted the wartime British ally in the United States. So he was fired from Cambridge University in 1916. So if Kant was the most famous philosopher of his time, Bertrand Russell was arguably the most famous philosopher of the early 20th century. He too was fired. So at the end of the day, what you see is a very different parallel tradition in the West, certainly when you compare it to India. So what I'm going to do now is conclude, because I really want to focus on Q&A. And I'm going to conclude with a little chart or a little figure that I drew for myself. Now, I'm going to spend about 5 minutes explaining to you what the origin of this and who came up with this idea. The person who came up with this, his name is Mallavadi. Mallavadi, a person, so that was his nickname. He was a Jain monk from the 5th century AD in Vallabhi. Now remember, Vallabhi in the 5th century AD, 5th, 6th, 7th century AD, was a great center of learning. And that story has not even begun to be told. Why? Because Vallabhi, of course, was a great university, a Buddhist university, founded by a woman, let's not forget. Again, this is not very well known. The inscriptional evidence on this is there. She was the daughter of the king who was a Shaivite. The Maitra dynasty was a Shaivite dynasty. The daughter becomes a Buddhist and founds Vallabhi. And more importantly, Vallabhi, only for a couple of hundred years, until it was destroyed by Al-Mansur, who came from Sindh by the sea route to Bhavnagar and then went up and destroyed Vallabhi. This is known from Al-Biruni's work and several other contemporary Arab works. But anyway, for a couple of hundred years, Vallabhi was about as flourishing a center of intellectual discourse as you can imagine. Now, why do I say that? Well, we all know about the University of Vallabhi, which was a Buddhist university. But let's not forget that the redaction of the Jain scriptures was also done in the Shvetambar Jain tradition. For more than 1,000 years, the scriptures had been scattered. So a great redactorial exercise occurred in Vallabhi, which collated all the Jain texts and came up with the authoritative editions. Equally importantly, the first known commentary on the Rig Veda after Vyas and the Niruktas is also in Vallabhi by Skandaswami, 7th century. Of course, we only have a very small fragment of it surviving. And the only complete commentary on the Rig Veda that survives today is that, of course, of Sarna from the Vijayanagara Empire, brother of Madhvacharya. So that's the only complete, but there were older commentaries. And the oldest that we know, after a gap of 1200 years, is that of Skandaswami. That's also Vallabhi. So Vallabhi was one of the most vibrant intellectual places probably on the planet around that time, where the Jain, the Buddhist, the Vedic traditions were all being debated, discussed, codified, and propagated. Now, in this milieu comes this Jain monk called Mallavadi, who masters debate, intellectual debate, and more importantly, writes a book about it called Dva Dasha Ara Naya Chakram. And he became so good, this book was so powerful, that on the basis of this technique, he bested all the other debaters who were, and scholars who were there. He defeated the Buddhists, he defeated the Vedantins, and the nickname that was given to him, Mallavadi, the person who was the wrestling champion of debate, Mallavadi. This book was presumably considered to be so powerful that once Vallabhi was destroyed, pretty much all copies of it disappear. Whether they were suppressed or not naturally disappear, it is not clear what happened. Because Vallabhi was destroyed, the whole tradition went up in flames, literally. So we don't know quite what happened to all the wonderful texts, only a few fragments of it. So this text, Dvadasha Ara Naya Chakram, survived only in the Bhut Lipi in Tibet. So one of the Jain monks who edited this spent 30 years preparing a critical edition, learned, I think, somewhere between the juries out of this 12 to 16 languages to prepare this critical edition, which was published in 3 volumes in the 80s. It has never been translated in any language completely. The first person to write about this was Professor Jitu Shah, J.B. Shah, from Ahmedabad, who wrote his doctoral thesis on this in the early 80s, or late 70s, I think, but didn't complete a translation, which I think he's been working on for 30 years. Professor Sushma Singhvi of Jaipur, Rajasthan University in Jaipur, has just finished translating the first half of this book in Hindi, which is jointly supported by Prakrit Bharati and the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, if I'm not mistaken. So that first half has come about. And the book, in my view, I have seen the translation. I cannot pretend to even begin to read it in Sanskrit. Perhaps Professor Kapoor would be able to do it. It is one of the most interesting texts, not just in the history of Indian philosophy, but in the history of world philosophy. Because why do I say that? Because he brings the rigor of logical analysis plus the depth of content. Now, why do I say that? It is as if you were to combine a Wittgenstein and a Heidegger, bring the rigor of a Wittgenstein and the depth of a Heidegger into the same package. My sense is that this text may take 100 years to unpack and decode and to understand, but it's now there for the scholars to look at. Now, why? What is the linguistic tradition that he uses? And this is something that we'll be using to Professor Kapoor's ears. He uses the linguistic techniques of Bhartrihari to analyze every single philosophical tradition that was known to them at that time. And the name comes from the fact that he puts them in 12 baskets. And he calls these baskets, and I will not go through these, he basically says that there are 12 kinds of philosophical positions that you can take. And each box has more than one philosophical tradition. So he will take one particular philosophical tradition and then he put it in that box. And then what he does, each box one critiques box two critiques box three critiques box four, and so on until box 12 critiques box one. And the circle is complete. So every point of view is critiqued by one other point of view. And then he puts in the center, because he's a Jain, the Jain doctrine of anekantvad and syadvad, and says this is how you can unify all the disparate doctrines. So it's a beautiful technique. It's a beautiful technique, and so I have coined a name for it. I call it the chakra Kendra technique, right? So it's axiality. So the point is, this is a way. Remember, we are not, so remember, when we say we respect all traditions, we are not saying that they are all the same. You can argue for the centrality of your tradition. You can say that we take cognizance of the other philosophical traditions, but here is where I see the limitations of those traditions. And here is my tradition, and here is how those limitations are taken care of by my tradition. By the way, similar exercises have been done by Buddhists using Buddhist doctrines. Say, for example, the Buddhist theory of causation in the middle and then putting everything around it. Vedantins have done the same thing, taking Advaitwad and putting it in the middle and looking at everything else as the manifestation. So this technique then is something that many other schools of Indian philosophy adopted. But the master who came up with it had, for a period of 1300 years, been largely invisible to us until now. And I think, I do hope that Mallavadi and all the affiliated texts that I'm sure will come to light once we know where to look. I think the next 100 years, if this text is anything to go by, can lead to a renaissance in terms of how India can advance the thinking about freedom of inquiry, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and plurality, and give to the world a framework that it so utterly and totally needs, one that it does not have at this point. So many books have been written recently about freedom of speech. I'm thinking in particular of Timothy Garton Ash's book. Highly, highly incomplete. We can complete them in very, very interesting ways by going back and looking at the Indian tradition. However, a couple of things are in order. First of all, it cannot be grounded in secondary sources. We have to go back to the original sources. And I think this is one of the problems of political philosophy and philosophy in general, that we focus primarily on secondary texts. We have to focus on the primary texts in the primary languages. So when we read a Socrates or a Plato, we have to read them in Greek. Because I can tell you, from having attempted some of these exercises, I'm not a scholar of Greek by any means. I read Greek very imperfectly and very haltingly. But I could see that from my perspective, the Indian perspective, I was picking up nuances that Western translators missed. Nuances that were part of our common Indo-European heritage. Nuances that were grounded in the techniques of inquiry into consciousness, which is India's unparalleled contribution to world thought. So if you take that approach, and by the way, when you do that, you see the Greeks also engaged in a deep spiritual inquiry. It's not just an inquiry into social issues or an inquiry into political issues. It's a deep inquiry into spiritual issues. Most of those, partly because they were also living traditions, most of those are lost, in fact, all of them are lost to us. Because remember, unlike in India, where the living tradition never disappeared, and so the techniques of sadhana were always available to us. That sadhana, that praxis, disappeared from European thought for 1,000 years. So as a result, they themselves missed nuances that would be available to us, because we can look at those texts on the basis of our own experience, on the basis of our own inquiry into the nature of human consciousness, and then basically come up with new and innovative solutions that are responsive to the present day. So with that, let me pause, and I would love to engage in a dialogue with this.
सारी लाइट लगा दीजिए प्लीज सर सो फ्रेंड्स दैट वाज एन एक्स्ट्राऑर्डिनरी स्पीच अ टॉक दैट वुड मेक अस थिंक फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम थैंक यू सो मच एंड आई एम रिमाइंडेड ऑफ दिस स्टोरी यू कैन टेल मी व्हेदर इट्स अपोक्रिफल और नॉट about Alexander meeting his guru Aristotle before he sets out to conquer the territories in the east, and he asks him, how should I behave when I go in these territories and start conquering these people? So he said, amongst your own, you remember that Alexander was Macedonian but very closely affiliated with the Greeks. So he said, amongst your own, be a hegemon, you know, like a captain. But amongst the others, rule as a despot.
And I was just thinking about another wonderful book on liberalism written by a namesake, Uday Mehta, who teaches in New York, who's pointed out that at the heart of European liberalism was the schizophrenia, that their liberalism was only meant for European societies. But colonial societies were terribly despotic. There were police states. Of course, they were in states too. So this is that fractured legacy of the West. And lest we sort of congratulate ourselves and start either chest thumping or patting ourselves on the back, let's not forget that India is a very intolerant society today. We have draconian laws whereby criticizing people in authority, religious authority or political authority, can land you in jail. There are sections of the Indian Penal Code where people can be put away. And apart from that, I'm reminded of that wonderful essay by Matthew Arnold, Culture and Anarchy, about the fragility of culture itself. You know, on the one hand, you have the Philistines who attack culture, people who have no higher calling, not refined or developed to appreciate. And so they only treat, you know, the higher things of life with contempt. And on the other hand, you have the Pharisees. The Pharisees are religious bigots and zealots who want to destroy everything that disagrees with them. And I think that we are in the middle of something like that. And I think Shailendra told us how fragile these ecosystems are, these universities, you know. How many of us had heard about this university near Bhavnagar? Vallabhi. How many? Very few. And how it was destroyed, 200 years. IIAS itself is a fragile ecosystem, under attack, so to speak. So I'm not one of those who always looks at conspiracies and threats. We want to do whatever we can positively. But there are people who think we are either too right or not right enough, or etc. etc. We won't go into that. But it makes you think that the life of the mind requires so much dedication, and so much energy and resources have to go into it before results can come. And I think we're so fortunate to live in India, where pluralism, you know, has been enshrined from the earliest times. But as Kiranji was telling me on the telephone the other day, the paradox of today is that pluralism is sought to be enforced in the most monistic and monotheistic or monothetical manner, that my pluralism is the only pluralism, you know, which is itself a contradiction in terms, because it is not plural to say my way or the highway. But please, let's have a few questions. We have another speaker who has come from Dharamshala for the Gandhi Winter School. That's supposed to begin at 12. So we can carry on for a few minutes. And I think you can serve the tea. Agar chai hogi to jinko chai aap pila dijiye, because this kamre mein bahut thand bhi lag rahi hai. So let's take a few questions now. Yes, sir. Good. Please say a word about yourself. Pehle apne baare mein bataiye.
I am Roshan Lal Sharma from Dharamshala, Central University of Himachal Pradesh, Dharamshala. I have a very simple question. Could you please dwell upon a little more on this technique called chakra kendra? Because as you talked about it, you know, I remain the way of Jarita, because I mean we still tend to, you know, hold on to these newfangled ideas that come in the West, and these areas tend to not just kind of, you know, terrify, frighten us, but also uproot to a great extent. So could you please just dwell upon this chakra kendra technique a little bit?
Yeah, I think so. The origins of this, of course, are much older than Mallavadi himself. In fact, the earliest reference to plurality is in the Udana section of the Tripitaka, right? So this is Udana, as you know, is the inspired sayings of the Buddha, the specifically noted sayings of the Buddha. So there he has this beautiful analogy of the nine blind men and the elephant. It's commonly called the six blind men and the elephant, but if you look at the original Pali text, it's the nine blind men. And the origin of that, as you know, is the fact that what Spengler called the axial age, you know, around the 5th century BC, there was this huge churn. And in the Pali and the Jain text, it is said that there were 18 major schools of thought at that time. So somebody comes to the Buddha and says, you are saying this, he's saying that, that person is saying that, whom are we to believe? And so then he basically shares this beautiful parable, which I think is the perfect definition of pluralism, which is that if nine blind men look at the elephant in nine different ways, or rather touch the elephant in nine different ways, then the person who touches the tusk thinks it's a spear, the person who touches the side thinks it's a wall, and so on. I don't need to go into that. So essentially what Mallavadi is doing, and by the way, in the Jain tradition you have the same story, later on in the Vedantic tradition also the same story is used. The Sufis use the story, Rumi, for example, uses the story, the Japanese and the Chinese traditions pick it up. There's even a poem in English about the six blind men of Hindustan, right? So this story permeated everything, permeated pretty much everywhere. So the Mallavadi is basically providing an intellectual framework for how you can still take all these different points of view and synthesize it by putting the notion, the Jain notion of partial points of view, the naya, right? And then synthesizing it. So now, having said that, I'm afraid I will not be able to do any justice to how he particularly puts Bhartrihari to work, the machinery, the linguistic analytical machinery of Bhartrihari, how he puts it to work to actually analyze different philosophical traditions. I'm afraid I have to indicate my limitation, my deep limitation. It will probably require at least a decade of close analysis for anyone to even begin to answer this question. And I think if I can make a plea, it is for us to convene a group of scholars around this important text to unpack it and take, and so hopefully in a couple of years' time, we would be able to come up with a much better answer. At this point, the two individuals that I would recommend that we invite them are Professor Sushma Singhvi and Professor Jitendra Shah of Jaipur and Ahmedabad, respectively. They will be the ones to give you chapter and verse and specific ideas about why and how these 12 categorizations were chosen, and then how the other dozens of points of view were then classified within that.
Actually, this is a really good idea. We invite you to lead such a school, a winter school or a summer school, and we'll call these scholars, and I hope IIAS is a wonderful place to discuss a text like this. And another point in reference to what you said, I think the can you hear me on this?
Yeah.
Okay. I think the wonderful thing about the wheel and spokes kind of schema is that you can maintain the centrality of your position and yet accord both respect as well as place
exactly
to all the others. Now, why is this important? Because in the modern West, when you want to dislodge, you know, the dominance of any of these singular ideologies, including Anglicanism, what you've created is relativism. So what relativism does is that all views are equally valid or invalid, and therefore you're lost in a maze of so many positions, and you're reduced to a solipsism, that, oh, it's your view versus mine. There's no view that is righter than the other. But we'll take a few more questions, sir.
This one, I have this inspiration with the mehta, this image of the chakra, and it's more, sir, in
in the Prashna Upanishad, in Prashna Upanishad also, this chakra image is employed. And in fact, I don't remember now the items or the points which are mentioned, but in the structure, there is the axle, which is naye, as you say. And the axle in the naye in the Prashna Upanishad is the concept of Brahman. Brahman. That's a naye. And then along with these 12, you know, things, and then the circumambulating field, there are elements which are identified. So it becomes a very elaborate cognitive structure.
Yes.
A very elaborate cognitive structure with the kinds of cognitive instruments or mediation done by different kinds of arguments and methods and ontological elements. And this is therefore, I think in the Konark wheel, the same kind of notion is there, although they say it's only time. And also in the political theory, the concept of Chakravarti Kshetra, again the hub and then the yes. So I think Roshanlalji, Namaskar. After Jain Jan hai, these are some of the texts that we will find.
Can we have, yes, go ahead.
Hello sir, my name is Devjani, I'm from Jabalpur University and I'm currently writing my MPhil thesis on the oral history of a denotified tribe. So, my question is that you acknowledged that we are facing the various manifestations of the evil that is casteism today, and you also mentioned that the criticism of such a tradition is already embedded in the philosophy of Indian tradition.
The
Shramanic tradition. So, since you are a strategist, I would like to know that if there is any way we can translate those embedded critiques into a logistical measure in order to combat it today.
So there's one which has not been translated, which I stumbled upon. See, so let me share this. I have been on this journey now for 7 years. And I have not, partly because I was uncovering layer after layer, so I hesitated to put anything before audiences until very recently. And by the way, the first time I spoke about this was at Jadavpur about a year and a half ago. So, and it was a wonderful audience, believe me. So, one of the things that I stumbled upon is the original, it seems to me, of the... So, if you remember, in the Shankar Digvijay, there is that episode of Shankaracharya meeting the Chandal. And the Chandal basically questions him, that what are you talking about? How can you make a distinction amongst people? So, who is pure, who is impure? And of course, Shankaracharya immediately concedes that there is no distinction between the Chandal and him, and he comes up with the famous the stotra in honor of that encounter. I found in one of the Sanskrit Buddhist texts, a similar conversation much earlier than Shankaracharya between the Chandal king and his Brahmin priest. And the context is that the king's son and the priest's daughter have fallen in love. And the priest is against this marriage. So they have a dialogue, and essentially the Purohit, the Raj Purohit, lists a series of objections as to why his daughter cannot marry the prince.
And the king refutes them one by one in pretty much the same way that the Chandal later on in Varanasi refutes Shankaracharya. In a subsequent life, these two individuals are born as Ananda and what is the name of the dictionary, I forget. And Rabindranath Tagore has this famous play called The Chandal Kanda, which is about the subsequent birth of these individuals. So the story that I'm telling you is the previous story. Now, in my, I don't know, so I'll make a claim here, I have to back it up, this is my hunch. But this is the first dialogue anywhere that you can find in any tradition about equality.
Remember, we talk about equality, but the roots of equality are fairly recent. And the reason why I say that is because even in the Bible, you have a deep acceptance and indeed support for slavery, right? And in all the Greek texts, you have a deep appreciation for and acceptance of slavery. And furthermore, Libanius in the 3rd century has this deep apologia, right? Where he talks about how the Christian tradition is in Constantinople stifling free speech. And he makes a plea for free speech by going back to Socrates, ironically, and saying, look, allow us to be free. So the point is that the notion of equality occurs fairly late in the Western tradition. They may talk about democracy, but it was the democracy of a certain segment. The idea that equality should be the birthright of every individual, not just that of a privileged class. Again, this has not been appreciated, and so I'm making this claim here. I believe that it originates in Indian civilization. And this story may be, and this is something that we have to dig and re-examine. But this story may be the earliest example of formal definition.
Last thing you have to question, allow me to make one observation. One observation.
Yes,
I know I should not be because
please.
See, no, I come. Sir, equality in the context of, and you mentioned there, you see, even in Aristotle's politics, slaves are the fifth section of society. So it's all authorized and sanctioned. Until Abraham Lincoln's Civil War, 1865, slavery was an institutionalized. On the other hand, this is something which you will have to go a little bit more with your energy and aid. Herodotus quotes one Cecilius Diodorus. Herodotus quotes the Cecilius Diodorus who came to India 2nd century BC. And the Cecilius Diodorus says that the Hindus have a strange law that no man can be a slave to another.
Yes.
No man can be a slave to another. Now this is very interesting. You compare, it's almost nearly Aristotle's time.
Yes.
So you could perhaps,
yes, I will.
It is quoted by R.C. Majumdar later from Herodotus. And
No, Augustine's the Indica also, he notes very clearly that Indians don't have slaves. But even more interestingly, I came across another obscure reference. See, this is the great thing about not having any preconceptions, right? I'm not a political scientist or a philosopher, I pretend to be one. But not having that baggage, I was able to just research freely and widely without any preconceptions. And one of the most stunning texts that I came across was a travel account of a Korean monk who came from Silla, which is the Sanskrit name for, and also the old Korean name for Korea, to North India. And that is available in fragments. But that fragment is considered to be so valuable in Korea that they curated a whole institution around it as one of the foundational texts of Korea. Something that we don't know about. Now, in his eyewitness account, and I believe this is 7th century, maybe 8th century, he says very categorically, not only are there no slaves to be found in India, but any attempt to enslave an individual would invite a penalty of death by the king. It's there. I have the quote directly from this travelogue of Haicho from Korea. And there are, and by the way, there's even a Hindi translation available of this text. So it's a pity that our scholars have not taken note of it.
You know, I just wanted to add a footnote. The real challenge for us is to depoliticize these questions.
Yes.
Because as long as there are opposing, not just parties, but sections, where, issues like you've raised can can fetch, should I say, not just political mileage, but dividends of other kinds, that distorts our perspective of what happened in the past. And that's why you said that he has no stake. You want to really find out what happened. Yes, sir.
I want to just add one more remark, because this is extremely important. I would like to believe that everything that I have shared so far, and everything that I will share, will not find any philosophical opposition either on the right or on the left. Nothing that I have shared is problematic to either the left or the right. If it is problematic, it is to the history of the West as we have been told that history. It's only problematic to that. And so what I have shared with you should not be characterized as either left or the right. I myself characterize myself as somebody who deeply respects the Vedic tradition, the Vedantic tradition, but I really come from the Shamanic tradition. So this is, if you will, the Shamanic point of view. And one of the things that I would like to argue is that these traditions in India have been in parallel, always in parallel. Unfortunately, the way we are taught these traditions is in silos. So, or in conflict or in opposition. And by the way, people move very clearly, very happily from one to the other. From one to the other and back to the other. Bhartrihari himself, as you know, famously
he went back and forth.
And in Nalanda, he was at Nalanda. And then he went back and forth so many times, he couldn't make up his mind as to where, and that's fine. We are all like that in the journey of life. So what I would like to argue is that let's remove for the moment the labels of the left and the right, and let us be very, very faithful to our sources. Let the sources speak for themselves in the original language. So if you're quoting a translation, as I have done, I've always quoted a translation, but in every case, I quoted the original. Unfortunately, I will indicate my limitation also. In the longer version of this, I will have to quote from the Chinese and the Tibetan languages that I have no hope of mastering in this life. So therefore, I will say that there I will leave it for the scholars of those languages to quote the original. But for the others, all the Indo-European languages, we should be able to quote in the original. And then the translation as well. And hopefully reconstruct our tradition in a non-partisan way, because there are some things that we can all agree upon. That inequality is to be challenged, that illiberality is to be challenged, that restrictions on thought and freedom have to be challenged, and whether we are of the right or the left, we can all agree on that.
In fact, on this note, I'd like to end our session, because there'll be many questions, I'm sorry. You can meet him later. And I don't want to derail the Gandhi Winter School. We have another speaker already. I want to propose a very brief vote of thanks. When we were planning this session, Professor Mehta put a condition. He said that I will only come when both you, that is me, and Professor Kapoor are here. And for some reason, since my joining, you know, we have rarely coincided, only twice we coincided so far. And everybody is busy, he's also extremely busy, but I'm so happy that before the year ended, we were able to conduct this meeting. We're extremely grateful to you for coming and you know, sharing your knowledge, your wisdom. Also, much to learn from the way you presented your ideas. And the note on which you ended, that these, I think, reducing academics and serious thought to polemics is a way to reduce ourselves, to stultify ourselves, to vitiate the debate. And we love to do that, unfortunately, because it's, you know, like Arnab Goswami, on television, academics has also become something of this sort, and you see, maza aata, you know. But then, in the longer run, it diminishes us, it makes us, and our tradition, diminishes our tradition, which was so deep, and was not interested in vitan, it was a real samvad, And between the Vedic and the Shramanic, there was a wonderful samvad for thousands of years. And I think that we have much to learn from Professor Mehta and how he presented his ideas as well. Because we are surrounded today by a kind of aggressionism, I call it, which is used as a substitute for deep thinking or for the knowledge of original texts. And I think it becomes a kind of shortcut, you see, because a combative and oppositional academics is also entertaining at some level. So I think there's much to learn from the Samanvaya tradition that you come from. We've really benefited by your presence. I shouldn't be thanking, I mean, our chairman is our own. We'll end up thanking each other, which I won't do. But I want to thank all of you for coming. I want to thank my colleagues from HP University. They probably have left. They had lectures to go to. But please remember, IIAS belongs to you as well. Thank you all. And I request the members of the Gandhi Winter School to immediately proceed to Siddharth Vihar so that you can continue.